Classic Rock Beagle.
Welcome to the Annals of the Classic Rock Beagle. I'm Dobbs and this is Moser. We normally review issues and topics from the classic rock era, which we define as roughly from the release of Rubber Soul in 1965 to the release of Hybrid Theory in 2000. I know, Moser. Just need to get through one more video, then we'll return to classic rock, I promise. Anyways, Moser and I will finish the review of the top 10 songs list. All songs made the top 20 Billboard's Hot 100 from January 1st through November 30th, 2020. What? Moser! I'm sorry, Moser is a bit of a purist. Well, since March. Can we start now? We'll start with the number 5 hit song of 2020, according to the rules as stated in the previous episode.
If you really love me, won't you tell me?
If you, hold on, sorry. Surface is formed in 2017 in College Station, Texas, around singers, instrumentalists Forrest Frank and Frank Forrest. Forrest Frank and Colin Padalecki? All you gotta do is leave it better. After releasing music over a period of 3 years without success, they re-released one of their non-hits, Sunday Best, in 2020, which hit the top 10 in several countries, including the US, Ireland, and New Zealand. Despite collaborating with Elton John for their follow-up, they resumed their lack of success right away. Look for them in a one-hit wonder bin of the 20s in a compilation near you. Vocal limitations are a thing. The vocal performance is not particularly good, nor the melodic line. But the melodic line is well enough and fitting to both the vibe and the limitations of the singers.
The song, same chords over and over again. This is just strict four chord song. Pretty awesome chorus, though they are.
The use of halftime here works well, and the drum fills at the start of the chorus set you up for the chorus. The bass and drums come in and out to emphasize the various parts of the song. When you break down the song, it is pretty simple. It's mixed up throughout the song like a complete break, going to the last chorus followed by a glorious organ part. The piano is the key instrument, of course. The bass comes in and out of the mix. It is a prominent force when it comes in. And at the end, oh, that sounds like an actual organ. Nice. Lyrics, they're fine. Nothing groundbreaking. It's a feel-good song if you're all about the words, "This has been done before."
Maybe Surfaces ends up one-hit wonders, maybe not. If they, as they likely will, go down for only the one hit, this one will at least be memorable. 9.5 out of 10, a legendary song. Next.
Did Dua Lipa was born on my 4th birthday. Yeah, we'll go with that. What qualifies for an album today is flexible. The singles released from Dua Lipa's second album, Future Nostalgia, Don't Start Now was the lead single in October 2019, before she even finished recording the album. Yeah. Oh, this is a beautiful melodic line throughout, at least for the verse of the pre-chorus. Although, minus one slot for the seal noises on the bridge in the outro.
Don't Start Now with Jarl Axel's help. Take 4. This song is so funky. It starts with just the bass and drums. This is on the verse.
Welcome to Duo Schooling Charlie Puth Part 2. The bass line in the verses and chorus kicks some serious ass. And the beat is thoroughly danceable throughout. Honestly, I can't think of a song in the 20-teens as much fun to dance to. Although, technically it's 20-teens. The bass line is a monster! Seriously, bass lives matter. No, really. They do.
Sweet Clyde, laugh derisively at him.
If you watch the ebbs and flows on the song, you wouldn't expect the highs to be in the pre-chorus, especially when there's no beat on that part. The chorus, the usual high point of the song, was pretty spare. That's a very interesting touch. Classic disco instrumentation in the verse and pre-chorus, although I'm sure the string line was done through MIDI. I don't care. The string line throughout is glorious. As layered as the soundscape is, I don't think there's a single wasted instrument on the track. It's interesting that the production highlights are in the pre-chorus. As for the chorus itself, it's
all about that bass, about that bass.
It's a perfectly fine, I don't need a jerk like you to be happy anthem. I'd give it a B, but it actually ripped a line straight from the definitive IDBN AJLY TBH anthem of all time. Observe. There are 4 songwriters. You think one of them would have caught this. This is a great song, but Dua, Gloria Gaynor, you're not.
Let me correct something here. Don't Start Now is not a great song. It's a legendary song. It qualifies so. It actually tied with the number 3 song at 9.6 out of 10. I gave the edge to the other song for being a little more unique. Next.
Baby, how you feeling? Melissa Jefferson, better known as Lizzo, released an EP, Coconut Oil, in 2016. Her lead single, Good as Hell, went to number 3 in the charts. 3.5 years later. It wasn't until Lizzo performed it on the 2019 MTV Video Awards show that the mainstream started to discover this song. Yeah, the melodic line in the chorus is a winner, and Lizzo has a really salty and sweet delivery on it. I love Lizzo's vocal lift before the last chorus. It's nice to see an actual talent win up, so it absolutely earns its A pluses as far as we go.
Good as Hell by Lizzo. Basically, it's a three chord song, and there is a fourth chord added just before the chorus. I don't do it like now, just to get the chorus. Here's that C thrown in just before the chorus.
I love the delay in the drums and in the chorus. I use my version of Come a Little Bit Closer. Give it a listen. It's not an original rhythm, of course, but it is refreshing in 2020. And hooray for actual drums and percussion. There was a really nice effect of a minimal pre-chorus before Lizzo's vocal lift, which added some drama to the mix. Classic arrangement, piano, organ, guitar, bass, drums, percussion, and horns or horn MIDI. The song has a very 60s vibe to it. As we commonly see in 2020 songs done right, the piano is the key.
Get it, Moser! Piano, keys on a piano.
You know, I didn't plan it this way. I graded the songs taking a cursory look at the lyrics. I break down the lyrics after the grades have been given. But now that I've slotted the top 10 songs, I found something really interesting. The lyrics for Good as Hell is the love child of Sunday Best and Don't Start Now. Seriously, it's a celebration of life because you kicked your ex to the curb. Gotta love it.
It's not, to me, the number one song of 2020, or obviously, but it is the best vibe of the year, even though it came out back in 2016 to Crickets. 9.6 out of 10, a legendary song. Next. I'm sleeping here. Mozart, I've already covered this song in the same format, no less. Fine.
Post Malone had been building momentum over the last half of the decade, starting as a derivative mumble rapper and gradually incorporating his own style. He released his third album, Hollywood's Bleeding, in September 2019, which sees Stoney return to his rock roots. That's him on the drums with his first band. The third single from Hollywood's Bleeding was Circles, released on August 30th, 2019. Remember, he broke out as a mumble rapper, not much different than Future or Fetty Wap. As a singer, Posey is much better on this song, though he's still very limited. And that is one catchy yet mature hook on the chorus. On the surface, this is as basic as can be. C, F, F minor throughout. However, with the varying use of major seventh chords, the harmonic structure has nuance and is somewhat interesting even if it doesn't vary. 120 beats per minute. That sounds about right for the song. The song is light but has energy. I like that combination. As simple as can be. I generally like a little complexity to mix things up, but I'm more than happy with this improvement so far. I'm not expecting a 23-minute prog jazz piece from Post Malone. Good job, Posty. Keep playing to your strengths. I love the production choices here. Post Malone kept it simple with acoustic guitar, bass, and actual drums. This is not the most advanced production here, but he has made the right choices. Pretty pedestrian lyrics about a man struggling with the relationship that has gotten into a rut. This isn't the high point of the song. Although, great use of word painting on the word echoes, my man.
I know this song that already made my best of the decade list automatically gets a leg up in the competition. Nobody wants to look stupid for putting a song as number 9 in a decade and then honorable mention as a single the next year. But since it qualifies the list, I had to consider Circles on its own merits. I made an honest attempt to reevaluate it, contrast, compare it with a fresh set of ears. What can I say? Posty stood up to the challenge. 9.7 out of 10, a legendary song. Now, if you think reviewing a song that's already made my best of the decade list is controversial, wait until you see my number one pick. What now? It met the criteria. Funny, I didn't hear you object and put Lizzo's 2016 song at number 3. And you think Todd in the Shadows isn't already thoroughly familiar when he puts his list together? Besides, why wouldn't you apply this objection to Circles? You know, Moses, that's a legitimate point. Except, do you seriously think I put George Thorogood or Winger on here if they had hit this year? I looked at the songs objectively, and this is one of the few classic rocks that could have beaten out Posty and Lizzo. And I had already established Dreams as an elite song. I invented the elite category after the Fleetwood Mac video, so I can't prove it here empirically. But my notes were Dreams, 10 out of 10, which is elite.
What you just said is one of the most insanely idiotic things I have ever heard. At no point in your rambling, incoherent response were you even close to anything that could be considered a rational thought. Everyone in this room is now dumber for having listened to it.
So anyways.
Fleetwood Mac came out in the British blues boom of late 60s. They were second only to Cream, etc., etc. Just watch my album rank on Fleetwood Mac to get a musical history of the band. I've made no secret about my opinion that I think Stevie's voice hasn't aged that well.
He said it again!
No, seriously, she lost a ton of range by 1980. It happens to us all. Yeah, by 2001, her voice still had the force of personality and was still on brand. But her range, yeah, this was still accurate.
Guys, it's Stevie Nicks! Oh, wow!
Nah!
Look, can I get a picture? Miss Nicks, over here, Miss Nicks!
Nah!
But before her voice changed, Stevie Nicks had both a unique and a very capable voice. And especially in going for the vibe of a haunting spirit, she nails a beautiful melody here.
I hope I'm not blowing anybody away with this knowledge, but Stevie Nicks has never been confused for Rick Wakeman on the keyboards. She wrote the song on the piano with two chords. And here they are, verse and pre-chorus. F, G, back and forth. I played the song in a band, and I didn't get bored because the song was so good, but I was only playing two notes for most of it. The chorus adds the... E to both chords. Interlude goes like this.
Mick and John are objectively a top rhythm section. Dreams is a textbook of playing rock in the pocket. If you ever want to take up drums and or bass, this is a great song to start with. It adds so much to the song without anything like a flourish, except for Mick's fill in the middle of the third chorus. Infinite respect to Mick and John. The interlude was well conceived and well crafted. For the rest of the song, the band did well to stand back and let the song that Stevie wrote with two chords carry the day. Whoa, amazing. Oh, for crying out loud, Mick's straight eighth note tap of the hi-hat is, oh man. The counter melodies on the pre-chorus is a delight. But if we're talking about the backing vocals, if Don Henley and David Crosby are the best harmony singers in rock, Christine McVie is the best backing vocalist. Her ooh going into the chorus sends chills down my spine. Stevie here doesn't stick it to her ex, whatever random guitar player that might happen to be. She haunts him. She threatens not only to haunt his nightmares, but his dreams and desires. Nothing about bitterness here. She's only getting even. That is confidence, my friends. Carrie Underwood, take notes.
Moser's so disgusted, he's not even letting me use the camera on this one. In addition to being everything I said about them in episode 2 of the CRB, Fleetwood Mac is a legendary band and a giant in the rock and roll pantheon. Dreams is the only number one hit in the U.S., and its comeback in 2020 is not unrelated to its quality. After objectively reviewing it and every song that hit the top 20 in 2020, I have to conclude it's the best song of the year. 9.9 out of 10, an elite song.
Went to number 12 on the pop charts this year and met the criteria we set at the beginning. Sorry. You never respected me anyways. Closing. I left a link to our Facebook page below where you can see what other songs we considered. We're going to cut down to 15. Be sure to mash a thumbs up on the icon below, subscribe, leave a comment. This all helps me with YouTube. You can click the bell to get notifications when Moser and I put out another vid. And Jarlok's had a very tiny part in this one, thankfully. But we just don't tell him I said that. Next up, an artist rank with a couple of candidates. So, Happy New Year from the classic rock Beagle, and as always, rock on.
Scene two, take one.
A and B. Anyways, Moser, Jarlaxle, and I were finished the top 10 songs review. Reviewing all the songs made the top 20 in Billboard's Hot 100 last year. From January 1st to November 30th. And cut. Damn it, Jarlaxle.